Okay, so welcome. I'm Emily Newman from the American Humanist Association Center for Education, and this is our April AHA speaker series. We're excited to have Dr. Juhem Navarro-Rivera, who is the managing partner and director of political research at Socioanalítica Research. He's co-chair of the Latinx Humanist Alliance, a member of the board of directors of the American Humanist Association, and a senior fellow at the Institute for Humanist Studies. Currently writes the Nonedecision 2020 column for thehumanist.com, which had an article recently published. And it focuses on how nuns and their role in American politics. So thank you again, Juhem, for joining us, and go ahead.
thank you. Good night to all of you. Good evening, depending on where you are. I will be talking tonight about the nones in American politics, mostly expanding from the Nonedecision 2020 columns that Emily mentioned that have been appearing since December in thehumanist.com. And I'm particularly expanding on the one that was published this week, which is the 5 reasons why secular Americans are poised to become a major force in US politics. Before starting, I actually want to thank AHA and Emily for all the work they have done in putting all these together, especially given the conditions and the pandemic that has forced us all to be doing this from home rather than in AHA headquarters. But I think that also means that we have probably some people that couldn't have made it to the original talk here in Washington, D.C. I want to switch to Spanish because I saw my mom in the audience and my mom has never been in one of my presentations. So, hola mami, saludos, bienvenida, y espero que te quedes toda la presentación. With that in mind, I'm just gonna continue properly with the presentation. So let's give a little bit of background of what we mean about, precisely what I mean about who are nones and what they mean in American politics. So nones are defined generally in the same way. So it's people who are atheist, agnostic, or they define the religion as nothing in particular. Now they have usually come from large surveys. The 2008 and the series that came in the 90s and early 2000s, the American Religious Identification Survey, which was kind of like the one that puts the knowns in the map, so to speak, with their finding that at that point in 2009, 15% of the American population were knowns. And then the Pew Research Center, which has done also some extensive surveys on religion, and finally, PRI, and particularly their American Values Atlas, which is essentially a yearly survey of religious identification in the United States. And they have measured that differently, but they actually have arrived to similar conclusions in terms of the numbers. For the American Religious Identification Survey, it was a question of what is your religion in anything? And then you just wrote, or actually in those cases, those times, it was a phone survey, you told the interviewer what was your religion, and then those had to be back-coded. But generally the definition was, or usually the most common responses were known or nothing in particular, which is where the known terms come from, and then atheists and agnostics. For AVA or PRI and the Pew Research Center, they usually ask a question, what is your religion, if any, and then read you a list. So usually people who answer atheist, agnostic, or nothing in particular are the ones who are kind of lumped together. So that's what it means to be a known. Now the 5 reasons why, so I'm gonna talk about, we already talked a little bit about the background in terms of defining the secular population. And then we're gonna also talk a little bit about knowns in American elections, a short primer of where have things been before 2020. After that, we're gonna talk a little bit about the 5 reasons. And these are the 5 reasons why they're poised to become a major force. It's youth, so we have the advantage of time, so to speak, diversity, there's care about the issues that I think are going to be very important in the future. Then there's, I'm going to talk a little bit about secular activism, particularly in terms of politics. And finally, office holding, or what I call the last frontier of knowns. And then a little bit of closing remarks in terms of what I think is going to happen 2020 and beyond. So with secular religious identification, this means what I was talking before in terms of how people how secular people identify themselves when they're asked about their religion. And for the most part, over 6 in 10 identify as non-religious. Then a smaller percentage identify as atheist, and even a smaller percentage of them identify as agnostic. This is kind of like the 24-25% of Americans who identify as non-religious are kind of like disclosed like this. This data comes from a survey that Socioanalytica Research conducted last year, the Secular Voices Survey, and basically asked this question, was only of secular Americans, and this was the question that was used to screen those respondents. And these numbers have been fairly consistent. So generally, most people or most knowns identify their religion as nothing in particular. A subset identify as atheist and agnostic as religion, and that means something slightly different from what it means when you ask about belief. This one also coming from the Secular Voices survey, I actually recreated replicated a question that we did in 2008 in the American Religious Identification Survey. And those were, what's your belief about, what's your belief in God? And the five options were, there's no such thing, which is atheist. There's no way to know, which is what we called in there a hard agnostic. I'm not sure, which is was a self-agnostic. And then two believer categories, which were deist, which is I believe in a higher power. And then like the theistic response, which is there is a God, like, you know, what they call the personal God. It's a God that, you know, it's a person I can interact with him. And I assume most people assume that answer that. And in general, the interesting thing is that in 2008, so these questions are asked 11 years apart. Back in those days, the majority of non-religious people were believers. So they were 27% actually were those who believe in a personal God, and 24% believe in a higher power. Right now, this younger group is actually moving toward a more non-realistic or more not theistic view of religion, or more non-theistic view of God. Now, if we move, so this is what, this is the population we're talking about. Now, if we move about in terms of talking about the politics of the gnomes, you know, they tend to be more Democratic than Republican, but a bunch of them are independents, at least in the way they identify initially. But in terms of the vote, which was the first Nonedecision 2020 column back in November, when we look at the exit polls back to 1980, the nones have generally been Democratic leaning in their voting. With the exception of 1980, which was a really interesting election by itself, because it generally the nones voted for the, or most nones voted for the winner, or at least the plurality of nones voted for the winner, that was Jimmy Carter, but only by a 5% margin over who eventually became President Reagan in that election. But a large percentage voted, particularly for John B. Anderson, who was a moderate Republican from Illinois who ran as an independent in that year, and a couple of other candidates. Then over time, the gap has widened, especially in the 90s. A lot of knowns voted for Ross Perot. And then after that, essentially Republicans have remained in 30%. They went down to the 20s during the Obama years, and they have remained there while the knowns have gone from 60-ish percent to two-thirds or even three-quarters in the second Obama election. And in the last election in 2016, it was actually two-thirds of knowns voted for Hillary Clinton and a quarter voted for President Trump. So these have been very consistent, and we're gonna go a little bit into these numbers when we move into other sections. But in generally, what we have noticed is that what I call is an organic movement, not an organized bloc. So the knowns have been voting similarly for decades, but there haven't been many efforts to court their votes, either from the parties or many organized efforts to make them a bloc, so to speak. But you know, if they're moving democratic over time, what it matters is the first point that we're gonna talk about now, which is the youth. And so I'm starting with youth because it's kind of like the most obvious point, and the conversations about the young of the knowns in American society, particularly in the press, have been essentially talking about how, you know, like people under 30 generally, but that people under 30 in 2008 are now in their 40s, many of them, I count myself in there. But that youth wave hasn't abated. Like for years, there was assumption that people, as they aged, became more religious. That hasn't really happened with this particular cohort of knowns. Like, you know, they were young and non-religious and they haven't gone back to church. So the youth has become more secular in subsequent years. So millennials were blamed for the death of religion in the last decade, and now Gen Z is blamed for the death of religion in this decade. And it's a very important point, because if we look at the three major religious groups, and I use religion with quote marks, because of course the nones are not really a religious group. If we look at the two largest other groups, which are the Catholics and Protestants, Protestant being the plurality of the country, and then Catholic and nones being of equivalent sizes these days, although nones have already passed them in surveys. We see that the nones, like essentially two-thirds of the nones almost, are under the age of 50, and all three in 10 are essentially under the age of 30. So it's a very young group that is. Many of them are coming of age. Also, the other two groups, particularly the Protestant group, it's particularly old. So the trends are reverse. So the majority of Catholics are over 50, a quarter are over 65. The majority of Protestants, almost 6 in 10, are over the age of 50, and nearly 30%. Are over the age of 65. So when we look at, you know, electoral trends, we see that there's actually a promising future for non-religious people, that they actually not only becoming a larger share of the population, but they are becoming a larger share of the people who are entering politics. And so mobilization is gonna be a very important aspect of this particular cohort. Because one of the conversations, going back to the beginning and those numbers about, you know, vote, is that whether the knowns vote less or they have lower voter turnout. And part of it may be due to the age, right? Younger people are less likely to vote than older people. But as this group continues aging, if there's efforts to mobilize that youth energy, it could go somewhere. And then this one, I want to show it because initially I showed just Catholics, Protestants versus nones, but when we talk about the religious right and when we talk about the groups that, you know, concern a lot of the leadership of secular movement organizations, and we talk about groups that, you know, hold a lot of power in American politics, we essentially are talking about the white evangelical Protestants, who are like kind of like the core of the Republican Party. And they're even older than the average Protestant. So they are over 60% over at the age of 50, nearly 30% over the age of 65. And actually, if you look at their numbers compared to the nones, are actually reversed. So the nones are not only just growing demographically, they're also young. And this group is not just shrinking demographically, but they're not being replaced by younger evangelicals. So if we think about why this moment in history is so important, it's because this group knows that they have a demographic time bomb and they have to use all the power that they can before it's too late. And that may explain a lot of the behavior we have seen over the last few decades from the religious right that is particularly led by this group. The second point I want to make is about diversity. And it's because when we talk about knowns, there's not much discussion about diversity. And it's interesting, last month I was in Santa Barbara doing a presentation with Professor Joseph Blankholm of the Religious Studies Department. And I wanted to focus on this diversity. And we were talking about gender, race, and sexuality in particular. And here I'm going to focus more on race and ethnicity. But it's the fact that when we think about the knowns, we generally, or at least the narrative hasn't been about a very diverse population, is usually, you know, young white kids in college who are like, you know, leaving religion. But, you know, maybe they'll come back anytime soon. We have seen that that is not happening. But also it's the fact that it's not just white college kids. And so in this chart, I have the three major religion groups, so the nones, the Catholic, and the Protestants, but also the U.S. total population and the racial distribution. So we have, like, you know, in yellow, we have white Americans, Black Americans in green. In bluish green, we have Latinx Americans and all other groups. In blue. And by the way, all the previous data and this one are coming from the Cooperative Congressional Electoral Studies from 2018, which is a large election survey out of Harvard University, and that, you know, asked 60,000 Americans about the 2018 election. They have been doing this for a number of years. And essentially, if we look, like, you know, 2/3 of the American population are white, and so are the knowns. But the diversity of knowns, Catholics, and Protestants, it's quite different. So Protestants tend to be overwhelmingly white, but the largest non-white group is actually Black Americans. So, you know, the vast majority of Black Americans being Protestant. For Catholics, it's a white majority with a large and growing segment of Latinx parishioners or core religionists. And for the nones, they actually look like the general population. So, you know, they're as white as the general population, as Black, Latino, Latinx, or other non-white groups. Within this particular cohort. And of course, there's been a presence of Black and Latinx and other groups. We can talk about Black non-believers as one of the big groups in our movement, or, Hispanic American free thinkers, about other important group. So, but though these voices are not generally heard, and people don't necessarily think about the nones as a group that is very, very diverse. And politically, this matters because, as we're going to see in the next slide, which is a little bit complicated, so I'm going to explain it. So essentially, these numbers, if you look toward the left, is going to be, or toward my left, because I'm looking at my screen, it's going to be in red. So that means groups that are lean more Republican. So that's the ratio of Republicans for every Democrat. Who identifies a Republican compared to Democrats. And if you look on the right, the blue bars are groups that lean Democratic. And if you look all the non-religious groups, so Black nones, Latinx nones, and White nones, all lean Democrat. So they're more Democrat than Republicans. In the case of Black nones, there's nearly 10 Democrats for every Black Republican who is not religious. For Latinx, it's about a ratio of 4-1. And for the for whites, it's about like 2.5 or so for every Democrat for every Republican. The nones, white nones are the only racially white group, religious group that actually leans Democratic. And so if you look at, you know, white evangelicals and Black Protestants, which is white evangelical at the bottom, and what Black Protestants, which are the second bar from the top, they are diametrically opposed. Latinx Catholics are on the other side of white Catholics. So they don't agree politically. They may believe in the same God, they may hang out with the same Pope, but they definitely don't agree politically. So the nones agree that they don't really care about religion, also agree on other political matters, or at least in political identification. And so this is important because as we move toward, if we look at those election numbers, that nones have becoming more Democratic, or at least a larger segment of the Democratic coalition, even when they may vote at lower rates, they're still becoming a larger part of the Democratic electorate. This is fueled by these young, diverse group. So we have to keep that in mind, that the nones coalition is not just a racial coalition of like white nones or Black nones. It's a diverse coalition of white, Black, Latinx, and other racial groups. I'm gonna mention a little bit about gender, which I actually didn't add a slide, but when we did the research in 2008, there were 60% of nones were men, and 40% were women, which was one of the groups with one of the widest skews in terms of gender representation. The last survey analyzed, which was DCCES and also the American Values Atlas, have similar numbers, which is have dropped down in about a decade, has dropped down to 45-55, which is amazing. And if you look at the younger cohort, they're essentially 50% men, 50% women. So this is not just a white male movement and not a white male demographic phenomenon, but it's divided across gender and divided across race. And I just found this data point. I want to finish with this data point, this section, because I just found this number this week. So PRI just released their results from the American Values Atlas. And the American Values Atlas is this large survey. Depending on the year, it may have ranges from 60 to 100,000 cases. So they ask people religious identification, they ask some attitudinal questions, and of course demographic questions. And they have tacked on a question about LGBT identification, so whether you identify as gay, lesbian, bisexual, or transgender. And they just released a report on those numbers. And this chart is ridiculously large. But among all Americans, you know, 24% identified as known or as PRI defined as unaffiliated. But 47% of people who identify as LGBT are non-religious. Now, that is not surprising. Because, you know, back in the day when I was working at PRI, we did a survey on LGBT issues, and a lot of people that identified as non-religious reported in a follow-up question that, you know, one of the reasons why the knowns, or why they left religion was because of over the treatment of LGBT people. Now, we didn't know if those people were LGBTQ themselves or not. It could be the case, but also that, you know, the ascendancy of the gay rights movement, LGBT rights movement, has actually led a lot of people to leave religion in some way or another, whether questioning their treatment of their fellow human beings have met them question what they believe about a God that doesn't accept their friends. We don't know the causal mechanism, but certainly LGBT Americans are the most non-religious demographic in the country. And essentially, the nones are the most LGBT identified group. So for all Americans, PRI found about 5% identify as LGBT, but for the nones, it's essentially about 10%. They're twice as likely not just to be LGBT, but twice as likely to be non-religious if you're LGBT. Third, I want to talk about the issues. This is important because, you know, elections are not just about candidates, but essentially about visions. And sometimes, oftentimes it's issues what matters on how people inform their views and their political lives. And in this case, the knowns have been caring about the issues of the future. So when we look at the top three critical issues, and you know, this is a PRI poll from last year, their flagship American Value Survey, they asked people to rank their top three issues. So the nones were the only ones who identified climate change as their top issue, which is not surprising because they're the youngest. And of course, there's that science component to it. One of my previous non-decision columns was about how nones are the most likely to, you know, accept evolution as a fact. and about the importance of science in decision-making. So it's not surprising that that youth and that focus on science leads to climate change being the top issue. Then we have healthcare, which is a unifying issue generationally, right? Like older people, you know, we're now in the middle of the pandemic. So we have that older cohort of knowns do care about healthcare, but also younger people who like don't have good health insurance, who have not access to health services. So that's it's a you know, those are the kind of like the top two issues, which I think are going to be the issues of the future, particularly exacerbated by this current pandemic, as many people losing health insurance as they're losing their jobs. Now the interesting thing about, if you look at this chart overall, is in the green it's immigration. And the groups that most care about immigration are the most conservative groups. So when you look at, you know, white Protestant and white Catholics, there are the groups where like immigration rises to the top of their agenda and their concerns. And as we will see soon, it's not because they care about the farewell of immigrants in particular. And so if we look, this is from the same survey. And so there was a series of questions about policies restricting immigration I don't remember if it was the Muslim ban which was asking the survey, or was the it was about border crossing. And then there was views about, and there another battery of questions about views of immigrants, where you have a like a positive view, you thought they contributed to American society rather to be a threat to American culture and values. When you see on the green side, those who favor restrictive immigration policies, the majority of white evangelical Protestants, white mainland Protestants and Catholics are in there supporting those restrictive immigration policies. On the other side are the knowns who actually are opposed to restrictive immigration policies. Some years ago, I wrote a column about how the knowns were actually not just welcoming in terms of immigration attitudes, but also many knowns are immigrants themselves. So there's a large immigrant population within the secular community that is also not something that is very talked about, particularly because as a group, many knowns are also highly educated. They have contact with people from other countries. And of course, like as a growing Latinx and Asian presence in the community, that also means people who may be immigrants themselves or may know people who are immigrants. And so that explains a lot of these positive attitudes toward immigrants and this opposition to immigration restrictions. Then when we go about to views of immigrants, even though generally Americans say they have positive views, as you see, most Americans of all groups, religion groups, actually said that they were positive, actually knowns actually stood out for having the most positive views, even looking at that. And the other issue, it's like the biggest issue of the election, is knowns have been very animated about Donald Trump. So this is from a previous survey the previous year, this question about the dignity of the presidency. And the knowns are characterized by the fact that they're the most likely to think that the president has damaged the dignity of the presidency. Last year, the Socioanalítica survey also found that only 14% of knowns intended to vote for Trump, or were sure to vote for Trump. PRI polls and Pew polls have consistently found the knowns to be the least Trump supportive religious cohort. And so this is very important in this particular election, because a lot of the mobilization is gonna come down to that particular point, like whether you approve or like the president, what he's doing. And also because it matters to activism. So when we're looking at, you know, like the terms that are banding around, like enthusiasm, it matters when we talk about activism. And this is actually the next point that I'm going to make. So we're going to be talking now about activism. And so, you know, when we talk about the knowns, usually there's this aspect of like they being an apathist, the term that has been bandied around, which is that essentially nones just don't care about religion, but they don't really care about anything else, about participating. That's why they have low voter turnout, as is being assumed, or they don't participate in groups, because they, you know, there's this assumption that the that, you know, church participation is like one of the apexes or the most important ways in which American participate in civic life. So not going to church is actually a detriment to that active public participation. But in recent, a few weeks ago, Professor Ryan Burr published a piece in a group blog titled Religion in Public, for several scholars of religion and politics published, about the analyzing also the CCES data that I've been showing in this presentation, showing that the atheists, people who identify as atheists, are the most active. They have a battery of questions about whether people vote in elections, whether they talk to their friends about politics, whether they have attended a protest, they have signed petitions. So knowns across the board are most likely, atheists across the board are most likely to report these activities. And I wanna make the caveat that it's atheists as defined by themselves. So it's not the atheists as defined as belief. And the reason I mentioned that caveat is because when we talk about the beginning about how people identify themselves, so the percentage of atheists in the community is very different from the people who identify the religion as atheist. It's because that particular subgroup that identifies atheist or agnostic tends to be more activist than the other cohort. And so when we look at this, we actually asked this question, and it was published in The Humanist, I believe in September or October last year. And essentially I did this a little bit different in the Socioanalítica Secular Voices Survey, which was not only asked about participation in activities, but also there was a question included about whether you belong to secular groups. So the groups included American Atheists, American Humanist Association, Center for Inquiry, the Freedom from Religion Foundation, the Secular Coalition of America, or if you have ever belong to online groups, which are a very important backbone of a lot of communities, particularly when people don't know where their other non-religious people, they have congregated online to create those virtual communities. And then some people realize that they live close by and create local groups. So the people who have ever reported, so they were asked whether have you have ever belonged to a group, whether you're current a member, or you have never belonged. So people who reported that they have at least ever belonged, even if they're not current a member of a group, are more likely to engage in these kinds of activities. And particularly, a quarter of nones have reported that they were affiliated with a secular group of some sort. The people who were affiliated in secular groups were almost four times more likely to give money to a political organization, three times more likely to volunteer for a candidate, and four times more likely to take part in a neighborhood march. So when we talk about the nones not being a very active group, that's not true. They're very active. And not only that, while we don't know the causal mechanism, are people who join secular groups more active otherwise? I don't think it matters, because if people who are active are joining secular organizations, I think secular organizations should take advantage, or not necessarily take advantage, but certainly look at that energy as a way to boost the political profile of the community as a whole. And if it's people who are joining the secular movement and then decide to become more active politically, that's not even a bad thing. That is great. But I think this has to be more visible, like secular organizations as nexus of this kind of participation.
Juhem, I just want to jump in here and ask if this is specifically just national organizations or covers local as well?
Yeah, so the question included, like, if you belong, so they had the secular, so we had the large organizations as named, but also if you belong to local groups or even online groups. So yeah, it covered the gamut of all kind of potential groups that we could think of. And I don't have the numbers now because, I mean, there was the survey was not that large. So, breaking down more and more makes the numbers less reliable. So I don't think I can break down people who were only local organizations versus people who were in large organizations. I think that's the reason I didn't do it, but I could check later.
Sure. And then one more follow-up, because we had a question on this. This is, so nuns in a secular group are more active compared to
nuns who are who have never belonged to a group.
Great. Thank you.
And finally, so this is important because now we're going to talk about the last frontier, which is office holding. And office holding matters because if you remember, like, decisions are made by representatives. And, you know, for the longest time, since Gallup has been asking since the 1950s about atheists running for president, people don't like atheists running for president, except in the last few years that now it has moved over. Half of Americans now don't mind an atheist running for president, a well-qualified atheist running for president. Now, this is that wording is very important because, you know, in 2012, when people were asking the same question about a Mormon, that also the attitudes had changed over the years. Well, you know, a lot of Democrats didn't want to vote for a Mormon. Right now, a bunch of Republicans don't want to vote for an atheist, but a large majority of Democrats are fine with it. And I think it's how you think about in-groups and out-groups. Maybe when Democrats were thinking about a Mormon running for president, they weren't thinking about Democrats running for president, so they're not going to vote for a Mormon. The same way that when people are thinking about an atheist running for president, they're probably not thinking about a Republican atheist running for president. So we need to think about like that negative partisanship that has been floating around in American public opinion. And my screen wasn't working. But that is changing. So we have some allies, because not all of them identify with the group. Don't identify as secular, most of them. But we have a Congressional Freethought Caucus. I actually got these names, you know, they're in the website of the Center for Freethought Equality. And I look at their districts, and the percent knowns in their closest metro area or the metro area that their district belongs. The ones with an asterisk, I actually don't have metro area information. So the metro area, the percentage of knowns in the metro areas are coming from the American Values Atlas, which has the data by state, metro area, and region. And essentially, like, you know, 24% of Americans in the country are non-religious. So if you look at these numbers with the exception of Zoe Lofgren from California or Pramila Jayapal from Washington, they represent areas that are kind of like average in their percentage of no's. And that's generally a very good thing. This means that a lot of people who are willing to talk about free thought, rationality, reason, and being open about welcoming our like secular community are coming from districts that, you know, have your average number of knowns, and they may not even know like most of the knowns in there. They may have like active secular groups that are doing some good work in there, as it didn't happen in some places. But in general, I think it talks more about you know, how the visibility of the group has become as such that many politicians are not afraid of that kind of identification, not identification themselves, but actually association with secular groups. I think that's a very good thing that, you know, they represent these type of districts. And also that there's more people running for office. And so a lot of these members of Congress, which is the Congressional Freethought Caucus, are being incumbents. You know, they represent districts that they have represented, many of them like forever at this point. So you know, they have had some incumbency advantage, but I think the most important aspect for the group coming up, it's for secular Americans, for nones, is actually running for office and winning. That's something that hasn't happened that much. So this map, I actually created it last year, but actually 2 years ago. And it was the endorsement that the Center for Free Thought Equality or the Free Thought Equality PAC had done for that election season. And the amazing thing is that in 2014, when they started, they had like a few candidates who were like endorsed. And by 2018, like they had hundreds of candidates all over the country for all kinds of office, particularly as the state house and state senate, but also at the city council level. And now if you look at the Center for Free Thought Equality website, there are over 70 people who are elected officials. Like last decade, at the middle of the last decade, there were only 5 people openly secular or identifying with the community. Now there are over 70 people elected. So this cannot be underestimated how much this matters, even if these numbers are small compared to the large numbers of elected offices in the country. And I think this is very important also because as I was talking about the members of Congress who have been established, who have not necessarily been a member of the community but are welcoming of the community, but having people who come from the community who have been involved in secular activism for a long time in their communities, or not even for a long time, but have been involved in the secular communities in their local places, makes much more difference because that shows not only that we can grow allies, but that we can also grow our own champions. We can get allies, but we can also grow our own champions in elective office. And I am gonna start moving to looking forward. And so what are we looking forward when we are thinking about 2020 elections? So a few things. We discussed about the organic voting bloc. So this is, there has not been a very organized effort to get nones to vote as a class. So essentially like, the parties are not doing it, definitely not the Republican Party, but also not the Democratic Party. And like the issues that nones care about go beyond church and state issues. We saw in the PRI polls that they actually care about climate change, they care about healthcare. And when I did the Secular Voices survey, that also came out, which was also that, you know, a large percentage of the cohort did care about church and state issues, but these didn't race to the top. More people are more care about like what's happening in their everyday lives, about their jobs, about their about their education, particularly young people caring about education, and older people caring about healthcare. Crashing the party. And I think that the reason I talk about office holding is because there's, you know, we need to kind of like use the Christian right playbook. Like they started running for office and losing for office a lot of times until they built a critical mass. And so it's necessary for people that have the ability to run for office. It's not easy to run for office in many places. And I mean, in terms of resources, like, you know, it sometimes it's expensive, but, you know, I think it matters in terms of representation, and it matters in terms of like making a difference in the country. And I think it matters in terms of as the courts possibly become less friendly, as they have been have more and more vacancies filled by Republicans, that it's important to have political action. And so running for office is a very important matter. And the progressive needs the knowns, essentially because progressives are the knowns. So by that, I mean that when we look at the issues that progressives care about, and people who identify as progressive in a few surveys have also been generally the non-religious. So essentially, like when we talk about progressives in this country, a lot of them come from these particular secular community or secular communities. We cannot have, for example, a religious left being very successful if they don't have the support of secular progressives, because secular progressives are more numerous than religious left people. And finally, elevate the diverse voices that are in the community. If we're gonna create, whether this year or beyond, we're gonna create a critical mass, we need to show that, you know, this is not an alien group to America, but actually it looks like America. And so the many voices, smart and eloquent voices that have this community, whether they're white, black, Latinx, Asian, men, women, straight, LGBTQ, they need to be heard, and they need to be elevated by organizations and by communities. And with that, I think I'm gonna closing here. I went more than 45 minutes. So if you have any questions, I think Emily, you can relay on. Thank you for your time.
Great, thank you so much for that talk. And yes, we do have a couple of questions, and feel free, attendees, to keep typing them into the Q&A. We'll get to as many as possible. So there was a question, if you know about any information like percentages of nuns who don't vote at all.
Sorry, can you repeat that? I'm trying to read in here, but.
Sure, so there was a question about if you know if there's a percentage or what the percentage is of nuns who don't vote at all.
So I think I could give a number, but I'm not sure if I trust the number. because the thing is, like, you know, when you ask people whether they voted, like, usually people over report. So I generally don't trust numbers of people who say they voted. That's one. But if I look at the exit polls, what people have been doing with exit polls is that they look at the percentage of people that, you know, are represented in the general population, and then they extrapolate that to the people that the percentage of people were in the exit poll. So for example, like nones are 24% of population and kind of like 15% of voters, I think, in the exit polls. But that had, you know, I'm not gonna go into all the methodological issues with how doing that is wrong, but particularly for the nones is because I believe that the exit polls undercount nones. Because the exit poll religion question is not kind of like the Pew question that asks if you're atheist, agnostic, or nothing in particular. They literally ask if you're a known. And so a lot of people don't identify as a known. And so I think not many people, or there's a large segment of the population that is actually not doing that, like not identifying. So I think they're undercounted in that regard. The larger point is that in most surveys, a lower percentage of nones report that they voted than other people. I think that has mostly to do with youth, because nones are younger than other religious groups by far. And so with younger people having lower voter turnout, I think that's the reason, not necessarily that being non-religious make you less active.
And what would you say is the importance, or what does it mean to approach the nuns as a class, as opposed to mixing them into the general population?
Well, I think because, you know, they have unique issues that, you know, very few campaigns have been addressing to their liking. And also, you know, there is this aspect, and I think a lot of people in the community don't really like the moniker identity politics, but I would say that all politics are identity politics. And in the case of the knowns, like, you know, there's these communities that have formed in one way or another, where people agree a lot in terms of like how policymaking should be sound in terms of like science and evidence, and how, you know, the issues that are affecting them, like people agree on those. And so when candidates are doing their pitch, they have to think about these particular issues and communities that may not be unique to the nones, but the nones care more about than other groups. And so if you are going campaigning around, and this is, I think, something I didn't mention, but that it's very important, is when you have candidates for local office, nonprofit, secular, local groups can invite like candidates to host a forum and invite all the candidates, regardless of party. And so those candidates know, and I think it's more important in local politics because the margins of victories are smaller, or the amount of people who can change an election, it's more variable. And so go to candidates with your concerns and invite them. And if they don't show up, then you know who doesn't care about you. If they show up, then, you know, like maybe they want to vote. But also, I think that's why I meant, I used the term class, but, you know, I should have used a block. And it's that, you know, the nodes are voting like this, but they don't feel like a member of, you know, they've been voting for Democrats, but they don't feel a member of the Democratic Party. Most nodes identify as independents. And then they lean Democrat because many of them, like, don't like the Republican Party. But when you, you know, when we think about the relationship between the nodes and the Democratic Party, it's like, you know, the Democrats have been possibly winning elections because the nodes have nowhere to go. But if the Democrats don't engage them, like in an election that may not have a large stakes, particularly maybe at local and state elections, they may just sit home.
That kind of touches on this other question, but I'll bring it up in case you want to add to it. If you have a data point to counter the notion that Democrats don't need to target the nones since they already lean Democratic.
I don't think that's a necessary data point in the sense that, you know, we're talking about national elections in here. Like, so the, most of the data points are from national elections. So I don't have a lot of estate polling. So in national elections, I think because of the level of attention and because of the importance that they have gathered over the years, it possibly doesn't matter. We just saw like Trump win in 2016 without like having a real campaign organization. And Joe Biden, without doing much campaigning, actually essentially close off the Democratic nomination. So I think national elections are a little different. And at the local level, you know, a lot of people vote in national elections. So they vote for president, they don't vote down ballot. And so that affects Democrats, that affects Republicans, even for the, you know, smaller number of Republican nodes. If people don't know those local offices, don't know the state offices, so it's not just a matter that they're voting for, you know, the top of the ticket. It's that down ballot, maybe they don't know. And because they don't know, they don't care. And they don't have an affinity for that particular party slate.
So this is going back to the list of the Congressional Freethought Caucus that you had up. Someone was asking if you have the party affiliations of those listed.
They're all Democrats, that's why I didn't list that.
Sure. And there was also looking at the question of, would it make sense to separate the nones into two groups, the libertarians who tend to favor Republicans on economic issues and the secular humanists who tend to favor Democrats on social issues?
If there were enough Republicans to do that, maybe. But there's never enough Republicans in a survey to do that. And when there's enough Republicans in a survey to do that, they usually don't include the issue stuff. So it's a lot of the analysis limits come from the limited numbers of surveys that can do a very robust analysis of the nodes. But I think we when I was a peer, I did a survey of libertarians. Well, not a survey of libertarians, but actually the focus of was asking about libertarians. And yeah, libertarians, as we defined it, the survey was very different from people defining themselves as libertarians. We're more non-religious, but I don't think there are that many libertarians as people think. I think there's more libertarian elevated voices than there are actual libertarians in the movement.
Right, and I know that, especially on social media, you see sort of a divide between those are libertarians actually part of the party, and those are just calling themselves libertarian because they like that kind of anarchy independent connotation with it. Okay, going on that note about the Republicans, one question is, are you ignoring the deliberate efforts of Republicans to turn evangelical Christian pastors into Republican precinct captains, or the active efforts of the Bushes to turn Cubans into Republicans?
Well, the Bushes didn't turn Cubans into Republicans. The long history of Cubans and the Republican Party, I don't think we need to address here, but Cubans were Republicans way before the Bushes. But no, I don't think we, one of the things we, I mentioned at the conclusions was that we need to use that Christian right playbook. And I don't think, the scholarship on religion and politics in the United States in terms of the Republican Party is very vast. And so to a large extent, it was a lot of evangelicals getting involved in politics and knowing that with the Democratic Party moving into civil rights, the Republican Party was going to be their best chance. That's how the South turned. I think for the nones, that needs to be a strategy. It's like start joining party organizations and start running for office, and you're going to lose a lot. But that's what happened with the Christian right at the beginning. They lost a lot of elections, and eventually in the 1990s, they had a critical mass and they started winning. And they haven't stopped.
So we've got a couple of people asking about how they can access your slides and research so that they can share it with others, especially able to share it with some like local candidates in their area.
I could make this presentation public at the end. There's nothing in the slides. Maybe I'll take out some of the notes and comments, but I'll make a public version that you can share the link.
Great, yeah, and we'll, since I mentioned before, we're recording this, so we'll share this presentation, but yeah, we're happy through the AHA to also share any slides or PDFs that you, Juhem, want to share. We got a question. Can you talk about what the Latinx Humanist Alliance is working on and any work that it's doing to get its members involved in politics and or getting out the vote that we can elevate?
Not for the moment. We're in a time of transition. We're trying to see what we're doing now with the fact that we cannot get together. with the pandemic, and so we're reapproaching our priorities, but I don't think electoral politics is one of them at this moment. That doesn't mean that I know of members who are active politically otherwise, not as a Latinx Humanist Alliance endeavor.
And I'll add in there that the AHA is working on part of the Secular America Votes campaign with the Secular Student Alliance and the other non-religious humanist organizations in the movement. So we'll be publicizing more about that. And we've also connected with the UU the Vote campaign and doing the humanist version of that is Humanize the Vote. Someone was asking if you have any information on the main concerns of conservative nuns.
I don't think I haven't seen. I mean, they're mostly economic. Yeah, so I'm looking at it, thinking of an older survey, because the newer surveys, I haven't been able to break them down. But like the older Pew surveys that has some issue matters, they were more concerned about economic issues, particularly like welfare spending. And they were less likely, they were more supportive than like religious conservative of same-sex marriage, but less supportive than like liberal secular people. So they're never as liberal on issue. They're more liberal than religious conservatives, but they're never as liberal as moderates or liberals in the movement.
Okay, you had mentioned about being able to take example and tips from the conservative toolkit. Do you want to talk about any specifics in there, and maybe something that like local individuals can do?
Yeah, I mean, I think the better example is the office holding. Like during the 60s, 70s, and 80s, there was a lot of people running for office that they didn't win. Like they were considered extremist at the time, but slowly, people kept running. They built experience, they built networks, and eventually they started winning. Some of them started winning, and some of them started supporting other people. And so when I think about the religious right, I'm not necessarily thinking about the votes, because they've never been a particularly large group. They just took over a political party, and that makes things easier in many regards. But I think to me, what the example that has always stuck to me as I was reading this literature when I was in grad school, and some of it in college even, was that these people weren't afraid of putting their views out there in a ballot and throw the dice. And we need to see more of that. And we are seeing more of that. But if we're actually gonna change society in the next decade, we need to like turn it to 11.
And do you wanna say anything about how our current COVID-19 pandemic is or could be affecting our elections, and possibly more awareness of our secular groups?
That's when you ask about COVID-19, I was like, yeah, I'm not that Navarro. I have a PhD, but also I don't know anything about epidemiology. But no, politically, the COVID-19, this whole period has been so unprecedented, for lack of a better word, that I think it's affecting communities in many ways. It has certainly affected African Americans and Latinos, that we are seeing in the statistics that now are showing up. I think it may affect groups that meet in person. I know some groups that are moved there online, but I think the biggest hit is going to be for most groups, particularly secular organizations, is the fact that people are losing their jobs, and they don't have disposable income to support these organizations, and so they're going to have to start relying more on, even more so on volunteers, and they're going to have to start doing more with less, which is very worrying. Politically, it could go anywhere from people being so worried about like surviving that the election takes it becomes an afterthought, or people become really energized about the handling of the whole thing, But generally speaking about the election, my biggest worry is about moving, like, which I think we should do, move the election or make a big push toward mail-in elections in all states and absentee ballots for everyone to make it easier. Because, I mean, you know, if there is, and there's probably going to be a second wave of these toward the fall, like, that could really affect, and the groups that have been particularly affected in this first wave, aside from the people who are, you know, with more chronic conditions, which are generally other than age, are usually a marker of class. And that means that it's affecting poorer people, people of color, and people who generally, are affected by these other issues, and that they may also be affecting Democrats more, as far as I know, even though a lot of the conversation has been about it affecting older people that may lean Republican. So we don't know in that particular sense how it will be affecting.
So for our attendees, I put into the chat a couple of useful links that you are encouraged to explore. It includes Juhem's research with the Socioanalytica, the list of his Nonedecision 2020 articles on thehumanist.com, and also a link to the Center for Equality site if you want to know more about secular candidates and how to run for office. Juhem, do you want to leave us with any closing words or advice before I do announcements and wrap this up?
No, I just want to thank everybody for holding in there and listening, and, you know, feel free to contact me. I'm in Twitter at @JuhemNR. So drop me a line. There's probably the easiest way to find me. I'll share these when I kind of like finish. And Emily, if I don't share it with you in the next week, just give me a poke.
Sure. Thank you again for not only agreeing to do the speaker series, but also adjusting to our current situation and allowing us to do it online. So thank you all for attending. We're going to have the next AHA Speaker Series event on May 26th with Sakibu Hutchinson, talking about her new book, Humanists in the Hood, and also her work in the humanist movement. We also have, before that, some part two and part three of our COVID webinar series that we'll be promoting soon for local DC folks who aren't able to join us at the bar like we usually do. We're moving that to a virtual happy hour on Wednesday, May 6th. And just, you know, keep up with all of that we do and our partners in the secular humanist movement. And look forward to sharing this recording with you later. So have a good night. Thank you.
Thank you.